Good morning.
Morning.
Happy New Year coming up soon, very soon. A couple things I want to share with the with all of you. January 14th, combined service and soup and sandwich. So the soup and sandwich is coming back. And there was great rejoicing in soups and sandwiches. So it has the announcement about all the stuff we're doing, and it says, please sign up. You're not signing up to ordain Scott. You're not signing up to... You're signing up to bring a soup or a sandwich so we know what we're going to have, right? So sign up. Okay. New Sunday School class, January 7th, will start up. Oh, you can take a look at all of the adult classes that are going on. We have a full orb of adult classes and kids' classes go on week after week after week. Take a look at that. The new one's starting on the 7th. It'll be in room 204 back here, and you can take a look at that one. Also, an update. As of last week, we have gathered in a bit more than $23,000 for the Christmas challenge. So great job. That'll all go off to South Africa, and we will support the mission work that's going on down there where they're planting churches to multiply disciples in that area. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your grace and your love, for the opportunities we have to serve you and to serve one another, to serve this community and to serve the wider world. Lord, thank you for calling us to be your followers and inviting us to be part of your family. As we close out one year and move to the next, they're in some ways just arbitrary days, but the reality is a new and fresh beginning comes. So help us, Father, to follow you with a greater amount of energy and intent than we ever have before, that we might become more and more like your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
The heavens are telling of the glory of God. You may not realize it, but when the Psalms were written, who would have ever guessed that every star, every planet, every astronomical body in the universe pours out radio waves? Who would have guessed that? It's proof that the Bible is not just a book written by humans. It was penned and authored by God himself. The heavens are declaring the glory of God. It is now your opportunity. So let's stand together and invite each other to worship this morning. The Word became flesh and lived for a while among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. I would invite you to take your hymn books and turn to hymn number 267. In the background behind the hymn, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day, the words penned by Henry Wordsworth Longfellow. His wife had died just a few years earlier. His son was convalescing from being injured during the Civil War. And Henry himself had been burned so badly on his face that he wore a beard the rest of his life. He woke up one day and began to ponder, in the midst of Christmas, where do we see Jesus Christ at work? As you sing the hymn, you will walk through as he looks around and he sees what appears to be the absence of Christ. But by the last stanza, he is reassured that Christ has come and it makes all the difference in the world. We'll sing all verses. Thank you. Please be seated as you do so. You want to take your copy of God's Word and turn to Luke chapter 5. We're going to read verses 12 through 16 in Luke. This is the story of a man who had leprosy. And notice particularly the question that the man with leprosy had. It was not over the power, but rather the heart of Jesus Christ for healing. So Luke chapter 5, I'll read out of a New International Version. I would encourage you to follow along and keep your Bible open then for today's sermon. Luke writes for us, "While Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." And immediately the leprosy left him. Then Jesus ordered him, "Don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer for the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them." Yet the news about him spread all the more, so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. If you would, please join me for prayer. Father, this morning, there are some here that question not your power, but your heart. They know that you can pour out your healing power, encouragement. You can take care of finances. They know that you have the power to do, but they question whether the heart is there. Father, in the midst of wondering whether you really love us, may we discover not just words that say, "I love you," but actions. Like Jesus, who touched the leper, an act that would have rendered him ritually impure, something that those around this leper would have never done, probably for years. Jesus, who could heal with his voice, wanted to show how very much he loved, so he touched. Father, may we see again through the scriptures, over and over, your love for us. Father, we know there are many needs in the congregation. We lift up Eric and ask that the medication would work well for him. For John, who's home with COVID. For Terry, whose kidneys are shutting down. We want to lift up, Father, so many in the congregation, and ask that they would experience, in some cases, power for healing, in other cases, your presence, the fact that you love. Father, for some of us, it may not be that you so much want to still the storm as allow us to understand you go through the storm with us. This morning, may we listen eagerly to the word as it's preached. May we share with others the good news that Christ has come. And in spite of the news, in spite of our fears, Jesus is already beginning to make all things new. And he is beginning with his people. So begin with us, Father. Transform us. Train us. Teach us. Point us. And send us as ambassadors of the new world that is breaking forth even now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Want to give you an opportunity to share your voices as well. If you would, take your hymn book, turn to number 271. We'll sing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You. Let's stand together as we sing. Be seated.
Christmas is over, for the most part, I suppose. We've just finished a season of giving and receiving. We've celebrated Christ's birth. We've celebrated with gift exchanges with another. So the question is, did you get what you want? Did you get what you needed? Did you get some combination of the two? And I suppose I forgot one. Did you get stuff you'd neither want nor need? We'll see at Kohl's in the return area. Anyway, getting what you want. Luke gives us an account in this passage in Luke 5 of a healing that Jesus does. And he doesn't tell us exactly where Jesus is. He's in a town. A man with leprosy, this skin disease, a variety of skin diseases, approaches him, and he should have been saying unclean, unclean. He should have been distant from other people, but he approaches Jesus anyway, and he's looking to be healed. A part of the rules of the day included this yelling out so that others around knew that you were infected and that they should scatter from you so that diseases wouldn't be passed. So the man approaches Jesus, falls on his face, and begins to beg Jesus for what he wants. What he wants is to be healed. What he wants is for the skin disease to go away. What he wants is to be restored to his community so that he can be around other people. This past week, we were intending for quite some time to head to Columbus to celebrate Christmas. We would have been there with Jennifer's all four of the siblings, so her three siblings, their families, all the cousins, I guess we'll call them, or from Jennifer's parents' standpoint, the grandchildren would all be there. It would be a large group. It's something that happens almost every Christmas. But Grandma got COVID. Yeah, so she's doing better, but Christmas got postponed. And there was sadness in the household. Why did we postpone that? Well, because she has COVID, so it's probably a good idea not to be around folks in a small setting, get a large group of people around tables, eat together, and share together. So we're just going to hold off. In the same way, God designed and wrote into his law these systems for dealing with communicable diseases like leprosy to say, if you've got it, you've got to stay away. And it's no fun to be isolated, as many of us have experienced over the last several years with COVID itself. It's no fun to be separated from our families, not be able to do things, not be able to go places. But it's a good thing to do in order to keep disease transmission down. Well, obviously, God knew how all that stuff worked long before we understood it. So the man with leprosy is staying away from people as a habit of his life for however long he's had it. But then he comes to Jesus. And we don't really know exactly, because we don't get all the detail. How does he know to go to Jesus? But he knows to go to Jesus. And so he expresses his great faith and his great humility in the request. The first, there's his posture. He's on his face before Jesus making this request. Secondly, he's convinced of Jesus's ability to heal him. The man says, essentially, I know you can do this. It's not a matter of if you can, it's will you. If a person comes to you and asks for help, they probably think you have the ability to help them. We usually don't ask people to help us who have no ability to do it. So this man comes to Jesus knowing Jesus can heal him. If you are willing, you can make me clean. This is the kind of faith that we should emulate today. A faith that takes our issues, our problems, our situations, the things that trouble us, and we take them to the Lord and say, I know that you can do. There's nothing insurmountable for you, God. I know you can do it. I just don't know whether it is within your will to do it. God is able, but is God willing? We don't pressure God. We don't demand from God. We don't presume on God. We just go and ask. It's a part of what it means to prayer, to pray. And Jesus, in this case, chooses to heal him. We don't always understand why God does one thing or another, but in this case, he heals the man. But I want you to be clear that Jesus' main mission on this earth was not to heal. He had the ability to do it. He went from town to town, and he taught. And when he taught, there were opportunities for him to heal where people gathered together. And you can recall some of those accounts of Jesus teaching and healing takes place, or people come to him, or people brush up against him, or people grab his sort of the hem of his garment, and they get healed, and power goes out from it. You remember all those stories, those accounts, but that was not his main mission. Jesus wasn't intending to set up a series of clinics. That's not what he was up to. He was in the process of gathering a group of people who would be so committed to him that they would continue gathering groups of people to follow his teaching and to love God and to love other people on this earth for the rest of the time this earth existed. That's what he was doing. He was gathering up disciples. If you think back to Mark 1, he heals a bunch of people and all these crowds come out, and overnight he apparently goes off to sleep, we think, and then early in the morning the disciples go looking for him. And when they find him, they say to him, hey, everyone's looking for you. What do you suppose they're looking for? They're probably looking for healing. Everybody's looking for you. And Jesus says, excellent, let's go somewhere else. Right? Doesn't that sound refreshing, by the way? Everyone's looking for you, and you get to say, perfect, I'm out of here. I'm not saying, why? Because Jesus wasn't intending to be a healing station for physical healing on this earth. What did he say to his disciples in Matthew? The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mount where Jesus told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven has been given to me, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I will be with you to the very end of the age. Jesus did not say to his disciples, set up places of physical healing. It was part of what he did. It's part of what he did when he demonstrated the ability in one case to forgive. He proclaims forgiveness and then says, just so you know I did it, stand up and walk. But that's not what he was up to. His main thing was not to set up hospitals, although if you look around the landscape of the United States and even other parts of the world, many healing institutions, many hospitals and clinics bear the name of denominations or saints, because the church has always been interested in bringing physical help to those who are in need, but it has not been our main mission. In the case of this individual, Jesus reaches out and touches him, which, as we know, was totally unnecessary. Has anyone ever done anything for you that's totally unnecessary? Just put yourself in the position of this man. For however long he's had the disease, nobody's touched him. He comes to Jesus for healing, and Jesus not only heals him, but in the process of healing him, touches him, which would have been an unbelievably beautiful experience for this man. I say Jesus didn't need to touch him because we know Jesus healed from a distance. Matthew 15 gives us the account of a woman who has a daughter who's healed from afar. Matthew 8 gives us the centurion's servant who is healed without being in the same zip code. And John 4, a man's son is healed also from a distance. Jesus didn't need to touch him. He didn't even need to be co-located with him. He didn't need to be in the same zip code with them. But in this case, this man was touched by Jesus. What Jesus did was an act of compassion. It was completely unnecessary. He could have stood back and said, "Be clean," and it would have happened. Instead, he says, "I am willing." And he heals the man. In this person's prayer, this man's request that comes in person, we see the value of bringing what we desire to God. Do you realize that you never fool God by your prayers? When you go to God and you ask him for things, when you go to God and speak to him, he already knows exactly what is in your heart, and it is not something that you can cover in any way. This man was flat out honest with what he wanted, and he asked directly. Prayer should be honest, because God already knows, and obviously should allow for the willingness of God to answer the prayer in the way in which we pray and what we desire. Some people want to read the scriptures and say that God is obligated to do this or that, but that is not the sovereign God of the scriptures that I read. God is doing what God is doing, even if we don't understand it. The other point I want to make is this. We often focus on physical things. It may be because so much of our life, it was really earthbound, right? Because we're earthen creatures for now. We long for a time where we'll spend eternity with Jesus. We don't know what that will exactly be like, but we're so focused here that we're concerned with healing, and so our prayers often reflect that. We pray for ourselves, we pray for our friends, we pray for our families, those who are struggling with disease or issues, heading for surgery and tests and all these kinds of things, and all of that is great to do. God desires us to do that. But when we do that, I think we also miss praying for lots of other things. Sometimes it has to do with what we talk about and what we pray about publicly. Publicly, we raise this issue or that issue, and it really is revolving around physical things in people's lives. We're praying for the sick. And again, it's a great thing to do. But where in our lives do we pray for the spiritual growth of one another? Where in our lives do we pray that God will help us to remain pure in thought and pure in heart and pure in action? How about decisions that are being made locally and nationally and internationally? How often do we pray for revival? How often do we pray for the harvest of souls that God says is ripe already? How often do we pray for people to enter into a deeper relationship with Jesus and become more committed followers of Christ? The man with leprosy asks for physical healing, and that's exactly what he gets because God desires to give it to him. What happened to this man was very public, and when we read this passage, this is the part we spend almost all our time talking about. And we don't even really notice the last verse that I had Scott read, verse 16. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed, getting what we need. Post-healing, Jesus does what Jesus does a number of times. He tells the man, "Let's keep this between us," which never works, by the way. Instead, go to the ceremonial process, get approved by the priest so you can be restored to the community. Jesus, again, is not interested in setting up a healing ministry where tours and tours of people come rolling in so he can just heal them. He clearly could have done that, but that was not his main aim. Instead, he wants this healing to be on the down low. He doesn't want people to know. I believe it's because healing people in this way would have distracted him from his main mission. People would flood to him with requests. And so he was interested in going around preaching a message of repentance and turning away from sin, not just in one location, but all around. And so he continued to move. Verse 15 says as much. Crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed. Then comes verse 16, where Luke gives this summary of his habit. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. So the scene is crowds of people have been coming. They want to get healed, but Luke tells us of this habit. He goes away. But Jesus did not just hang around with the crowds. Jesus did not just count the number of people that showed up for his thing and report it to some denominational office. He didn't set up camp. He wasn't interested in all of that. Luke says that he often went away. In fact, it's confirmed in a number of other places in the scriptures where the writers tell us about times where Jesus went away. We'll talk about those in the weeks to come. To be honest, when we speak of this passage that we're talking about today, we often skip this section. But Jesus gives us an example of the rhythm of his life. He had a habit that Luke is highlighting. In contrast to the crowds, in contrast to the gathered people, he disappeared, went away to lonely places, to places to be with his Father. He escaped from the crowds over and over again, and we see it recorded in the scriptures. In fact, some of the times he tries to escape. Some of the time he tries to escape with the disciples, and the crowd follows him. But his intention is to get away. His intention is to move away and to be just with the Father, or perhaps with a small number of people spending time with the Father. It was a habit of his life. This week, because of COVID and because of our not gathering together, we had a Zoom or a FaceTime call with Jennifer's brother. Jennifer's brother has a son who is running at Ohio State University, and so he has been in training. And Daryl said to us, Evan's been like a monk. I don't think monks do the kind of things that Evan's doing. But anyway, what he was saying is he was orchestrating his whole life around training and being ready to run. And so not just the 2 hours a day that he's working out, but the other 22 hours, he's concerned with what he's doing to make it all enhance his ability to run. So he's doing things that top-level athletes do. They do really important things that are not very exciting. They sleep. You might want to write that down. They sleep, right? They eat good foods that nourish their bodies and don't add unneeded, unnecessary weight to themselves. As a student, he's got to pay attention to his schoolwork. So he's got to focus and concentrate, and he has to have a habit of life that gets him to where he wants to go. When an athlete excels, it is because they are paying attention not just to the public stuff, not just to the stuff in the moment of competition, but in the moments that no one is otherwise paying attention to. We just watched a movie at home called Greater. It's the story of Brandon Burlsworth, a young man who dreamed of going to the University of Arkansas. In the section of the movie, that one section, he arrives at Arkansas. He's a walk-on the football team, meaning he didn't get a scholarship, he wasn't recruited, and the coach tells him that he's overweight. And the kind of weight that he has isn't what he needs. So he's told, if you want to play, you're going to have to lose weight, then you're going to have to regain weight, but the gaining of the weight needs to be in muscle. Yeah, this is kind of a novel idea, right? So this 300-pound kid drops a lot of weight and then turns around and goes back up to about 270, but it's muscle. Who sees him doing that? His coach in the movie is working with him. His fellow players see what's going on with him, but they're not paying attention to what he's doing to get there. His public performance is one thing, but it's what's going on privately in the dark places, in the secret places, in the not-so-seen places. He ends up as a scholarship player the very next year. He ends up as an All-American player in his senior year, and he ends up drafted into the NFL at the end of his senior year. By the way, it's a very good movie. I highly recommend it. We often will focus on the public ministry of Jesus. We think about his teachings, his healings, his miracles. Walks on water, feeds the 5,000. All of these things that are recorded for us, and rightly so. But what we often forget is the habit of his life, the rhythm of his life, this particular one, to get away. To get away from the crowds. Habits are critical in our lives, and they shape the destiny of our lives. Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, "Sow a thought, and you reap an action. Sow an act, and you reap a habit. Sow a habit, and you reap a character. Sow a character, and you reap a destiny." Today, you might be sitting here today thinking, "I'm not exactly where I want to be spiritually at this stage of my life. I'm still struggling with issues like anger and pride and lust. And if I was completely honest, I want to be changed. I need to be changed. But it never seems to happen." One of the things we have to consider is that if you want to live a life like Jesus lived, you must live a life like Jesus lived. Meaning you must take time regularly to be alone with the Father. I've mentioned this book before, but on a different subject, on a similar note, though, many people in the United States have made it a goal in their lives to be millionaires. It's kind of a culturally accepted financial goal. I want to be a millionaire, right? So what will it take to get there? Well, of course, the very first thing it will take is having really rich parents. That's a great start, right? If your parents can just give it to you, right? Wouldn't that be wonderful? And other people say, well, the pathway to millionaire is I go down to the Duke station when the Powerball gets to be this level, right? And I buy this many tickets. And it's the greatest way or the easiest way or the only way I can think of to get there. If mom and dad have loads of cash and I'm going to get some of it, if I can win the lottery, then I can get there. It's the only way I can figure. But it really almost never works that way. A book was written a number of years ago called The Millionaire Next Door. I have Cameron reading it now. I think he's been interested in it. The book makes a lot of points, but generally it's telling you about the habits of millionaires, how they actually live their lives. Actual millionaires, not people who say they want to be a millionaire, but people who are actually doing it, right? And we've talked about some of this stuff before. Millionaires don't drive fancy cars. A third of them drive used cars. Half of them, the cars are more than 2 years old. 50% of them never received any money from their parents. No inheritance at all. On average, they save 15% of their income a year. Half of the millionaires have lived in the same house for 20 years or more. There's all kinds of findings. The same people wrote another book called Stop Acting Rich, which kind of fleshes out some more things, which there's a whole, I think I mentioned this before, a whole chapter on watches. What kind of watches people buy, right? The point is, if you want to be a millionaire, the author of this book has said, here's kind of a blueprint for that. One of the characteristics of millionaires is that they're frugal. Now, that's not the image we get, right? That's not the image we get. The image of a millionaire is they have super expensive cars, they have super expensive homes, they do all these kinds of things. But that's not actually what goes on. If you want to be an Olympic-level athlete, you have to live and train like an Olympic-level athlete. As the Olympics roll back into town here, we'll be coming on the schedule, they'll do little spots of, you know, they'll be talking about this athlete or that athlete, and they'll show you pieces of their life. You know, you get the swimmers, they're like, oh, they swim, you know, 12 hours a day. No, they swim probably 8 hours a day. They do all this. They eat this way. They sleep this way. They orchestrate their lives around it, right? The point is, the habits of our lives will take us in one direction or another. As we close out 2023 and move into 2024, I want you to think about the goals you have for your life in terms of spiritual development? What do you think you need to alter in your life to make room for spiritual growth? What new habits do you need to take on to head you in a different direction? What are the rhythms of your life now, and what do you believe they should be? How will you get there? Dave Ramsey, again in his book on finance, says, success is 20% what you know and 80% what you do. I bet if I surveyed every single person in this room and I asked you privately, do you think spending time alone with the Father is beneficial to your spiritual life? I'll bet 100% of you would say yes. But the follow-up question would be, are you doing it? Right? In the weeks ahead, I want to share with you some messages about things like slowing, being unhurried, being silent, just challenging you with some things, some patterns, some habits that could shape this next year, that we can become the people that God desires us to become in greater measure. Because that's what it means to follow Jesus, to live for him and to live like him. Let's pray together. Father, thank you that you offer us a grand invitation, not simply that we would have our sins forgiven, but you would draw us into a relationship with you that would alter the course of our lives and the character of our lives and the substance of our lives. Father, thank you that you take us from where we are today and you desire to take us to a new place where we are further removed from the things that have held us back or torn us down. Help us, Father, to put away more and more the things that are not moving us in the right direction, whatever they are, and inspire us and give us the courage to make changes, that we could become more and more like your son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
At the age of 18, I headed off to college. I went to Grace College. Later, I went to the seminary. Spent seven of the longest years of my life in northern Indiana. I would come home about every 2 to 3 weeks, at least in the first few years. And every time, my mother would meet me at the door, and she would be ecstatic. My baby chick is home. Years later, my son Evan, who was probably about 5 years old at the time, went off to the bathroom when we were camping. The distance was probably between here and the outer doors. Unbeknownst to us, when he came out, he forgot where the campsite was. And for 45 minutes, we looked everywhere for him. Finally saw him when the door to a car opened up and Evan popped out. And thankfully for the driver of the car, they took off before I found them, because I had questions. Everything was good, nothing happened to him, but I was worried. I was thrilled to see him again. This past year, Wendy was expecting her first grandchild. We camped out at a restaurant for hours the night we knew he was being born, in the off chance that Luke and Liv would make a phone call to us and say, you can come in, so Wendy wouldn't have to wait a moment more. What do all three have in common? The excitement we feel when we see someone. Perhaps they've been gone. Perhaps we're worried they're lost. Perhaps we're going to meet them for the very first time. Our closing song is about welcoming Jesus. I don't know who your person is. It may be seeing a spouse again, or a child, or a good friend. It may be seeing them over the holidays, or it may be seeing them at the resurrection. I want you to imagine the excitement that you will have to see your person again, and then magnify it. Because to see Jesus for the first time will be glorious. It's up to the church to sing about the Jesus the world has yet to meet. So in closing, I invite you to take your hymn book, turn to number 270, and let's sing with excitement, joy to the world, for Jesus has come. Let's stand together as we sing.
Father, help us this day to begin to think about the direction of our lives in this next year as we head into a new one, that we might live for you more completely, more deeply. In Jesus' name, amen.